So we'll start the webinar. Good evening, doctors. I'm Gaurav Mangol. I'm the marketing head from Sonoscape India. I welcome all of you for today's webinar. The topic of today's webinar is high-resolution ultrasound in rheumatological disorders, techniques in scanning and guided injections, and its clinical relevance. To conduct this webinar, we have renowned doctors and experts with us. Our guest speaker, Dr. Raghav Agarwal, our panelists, Dr. P.G. Rath and Dr. Sujata Sahni, and Dr. Riju Mathew as moderator. I welcome all of you for joining this webinar, and thank you so much for sparing time for this webinar. Before I hand over the session to Dr. Riju, I will just take a few minutes of you to take you through the new technology which Sonoscape has introduced. And the technology is use of artificial intelligence in ultrasound. So I will just share a video with you, which will provide you the information on use of artificial intelligence in ultrasound. So as you can observe in this video, that artificial intelligence technology equipment automatically identifies the structures which are coming on screen and provide you the information with just a click of a button. It saves a lot of your time, and it provides high accuracy in terms of results also. So without taking much time, I'll hand over the session to Dr. Rath. Thank you so much. Over to you, Dr. Rath. Over to you, Dr. Riju.
Thank you. Thank you, Gaurav, for that technical presentation. And we are happy to see those technological developments happening in the field of ultrasound with the help of artificial intelligence. So welcome once again to the CREST Kochi, IRIA Kochi webinars that we have already conducted 16 webinars ever since the lockdown has started. IRIA Kochi, the Indian Radiological and Imaging Association Kochi, has focused on subspecialty training programs for the last 2 to 3 years. We have had subspecialty programs, training programs, even with webinars on breast imaging, MSK imaging, fetal radiology, and every Monday we are having a session for PG postgraduates to present their cases in these webinars. So that's a PG webinar session also. it is high time that the radiologists, and especially the young radiologists, has to focus on a subspecialty. We cannot be a jack of all trades and master of none in the future. It is high time that we need to subspecialize, because that is essential to converse with the clinician and to solve the problems of the patients. So with that focus in view, we have planned a interdisciplinary session here with two eminent rheumatologists in the country. One is Dr. P.D. Rath, Dr. Prasanthdeep Rath, who is a board certified rheumatologist and a fellow of Royal College, and is a director and head of the department of Max Super Speciality Hospital, Saket, New Delhi, and is attached to other Max hospitals in Delhi too. We have got another eminent senior pediatric rheumatologist. Her name is Dr. Sujada Saini. She is based at Sir Gangaram Hospital, and she has several publications to her credit, and is an editor of two books on pediatric rheumatology that is published by the Springer as well as JP. And with these clinicians, I am sure the synergistic interaction, we will be able to get the insights of a clinician into the disease process and the manifestation. So what is required in the when we focus on subspecialty imaging from the radiologist, young radiologist point of view, is it's not just a multimodality synergy is required in your practice. We need to understand the disease process and disease manifestation from the clinician's point of view too. That is why these two eminent eminent rheumatologists, their insights, when they share with us for this particular program, that will be quite contributory to your career. But the speaker of the day, I have to introduce Dr. Raghav Agarwal. He is a well-known face in the Indian radiology and imaging circles all over the nation. And I must say that radiology runs in his blood. His great-grandfather is none other than Diwan Chand Agarwal, who is the pioneer in radiology, establishing radiology in this country. He has started, he is one of the founders of Indian Radiological and Imaging Association. His grandfather, Dr. Raghav's grandfather, is Dr. M.L. Agarwal, who was a professor of radiology at Amritsar Medical College and has done significant contributions to the radiology in India. His father, Dr. Ravi Agarwal, he's a fourth generation radiologist. That means for 100 years in their family, there has been a radiologist. So this is quite a bit of achievement in the sense many in this country cannot boast of. So Raghav, he is a very good academician, very good teacher, and he had been here at Cochin for the ultrasound guided procedures workshop and the MSK workshops. So Raghav will talk to us on this particular subject, high resolution ultrasound in rheumatology practice, and the techniques, the ultrasound guided procedures, and their clinical relevance. With this introduction, may I invite Dr. Raghav Agarwal to present the topic. Over to you, Dr. Raghav.
Thank you, Riju sir. Thank you for the kind introduction. I hope I live up to your words. And I'm really lucky you as an academician are part of the IRIA. And we have one of the most two brilliant young rheumatologists in pediatric rheumatology and adult rheumatology with us. They have actually been my friends and my guides and, you know, sort of gurus in teaching me, because a clinical aspect cannot go without radiological and vice versa. So, you know, the aim of this will be, at the outset, I would want to, you know, thank Sonoscape to actually support us in the educational program, and for Crest Kochi and, you know, IRIA Kerala to support these programs and to actually come up in a very comprehensive way. And in the presentation, what I will try to do is I'll try to simplify a very pertinent topic, because as we understand that, you know, we understand inflammatory arthritis as rheumatoid arthritis, which is prevalent in about 1% of the population. And in that, it is a clinical diagnosis, and we would try to present the manifestations in the ultrasound part, how we have the findings in rheumatoid arthritis, in gout, in psoriatic arthropathy, even in osteoarthritis. And then ma'am is here with us, Dr. Rath is here. We will try to cover about, we have a specialized specific findings in pediatric rheumatology, and we will look at the new recent advances in imaging in ultrasound in inflammatory arthritis. We have some interesting, advances which are actually coming up. And then we will be also introducing the injection protocol, which can be done in an OPD day-to-day basis. So should we start with the presentation, and we will take a break in between when the Prime Minister addresses the nation. Riju sir, will you?
Yeah, we will take a break at 8 p.m. and then we will come back, resume at 8:30 after Prime Minister's address. So Raghav, can you start your presentation?
Dr. Raghav, you can share your screen.
So, at the outset, we always know, we all of us are, well versed with the ultrasound part and how useful ultrasound is. So we have the advantages of ultrasound as a tool in musculoskeletal imaging. We all know about, the concepts that it is easily available and we can repeat the ultrasound on a day-to-day basis. But the major advantage, especially in inflammatory arthritis, is that in the dynamic imaging, we can actually show the disease process in various planes using the same setting. We can do the injection procedures in the same setting, and we can actually follow up pathologies on a day-to-day basis as and when required. And talking about why are we going into turf expansion or turf erosion? See, when I understand, like my teachers in imaging and teachers in the clinical aspect have been Professor Ian Malviya, who initiated us into learning. When I went to him, I asked that, I want to start imaging. So he said, first get trained and then come back to me. So, and if you review the literature, you'll see that most of the work has been there in the rheumatology journals. And a little bit was there in the radiology. And now we are catching up with our teachers, the rheumatologists, in the imaging in this. So in rheumatoid arthritis is a disease. It's a polyarthritis. It's generally a symmetrical polyarthritis, which is there in about 0.75 to 1% population. What imaging do we have to offer to them is a plain X-ray of the hands, which probably has a specific role to be played. It is a clinical diagnosis, but when we get referrals from the rheumatologist, generally the questions which they would ask is, what do they expect from the ultrasound? When you send a patient to you, what are they looking for? What will the ultrasound show? Is there any relevance? Like if I see a pathology, is it significant or it is just something which is not significant? And most importantly, when a patient is referred by the rheumatologist, will it change their diagnosis? They've already made a diagnosis. They already have their bloods with them. They have clinically examined the patient, and then they feel the ultrasound will add to the decision making. So does it actually change the decision making? So, like everything and anything in rheumatology, there are different protocols and everybody started doing. So I will start with this 2016 article in which a group of, rheumatologists, can I minimize it? A group of, just a second. Rheumatologists, there is this group, EULAR, European League Against Rheumatology, that they work together in forming task force for guidelines. But this particular group actually formed guidelines on how we do use the ultrasound, specifically in rheumatoid arthritis and generally in inflammatory arthritis. So they, in 2016, came out with guidelines, which maybe Dr. Rath and Dr. Sujatha might not agree with me, we'll discuss later. And but they said that for all rheumatoid arthritis suspect patients, if you are RT-CCP positive and clinically fitting in, is there a clinical sign of whiteness? If they thought so, do they fit in the ACR-EULAR criteria? So for a rheumatoid arthritis diagnosis, we have the American College of Rheumatology, European League of Rheumatology criteria, which have been revised over time, and the ACR-EULAR and 15 have taken ultrasound and MR as an adjunct to make diagnosis. Not as one of the criteria, but it has been taken as an adjunct. So what they have suggested in this presentation is, with a fibrillar criteria, that means a rheumatoid arthritis diagnosis by ULAP criteria. Right? And if they do not, clinically synovitis is not present, but your markers are there, and you think you do the ultrasound, you find the synovitis, and you don't find the synovitis. You don't find the synovitis with these markers, we keep them on hold. If you find them, then you do the joint count. If the joint count fills in, then they make a diagnosis. But even with all patients of rheumatoid arthritis by the ACR ULAR criteria, still we would want to do the ultrasound. And still, if you do not find the synovitis, we re-evaluate. And if you find sufficient joints, we some confirmed rheumatoid arthritis. In insufficient joints, then we manage for this assessment, whether you are treating for the single joint inflammatory process or not. And they also recommended that, you know, do a 3 to 6 months follow-up, see the clinical response, and if on the ultrasound no synovitis, or is it, you know, the synovitis is still there, then your protocols change about it. So this is available, you can actually read it. And
Dr. Rauga, sorry to interrupt, sir. Sir, can you adjust your mic? There is some disturbance which is coming. I'm so sorry for that.
Is it all right? Hello?
Yeah, because I think it's moving. That's why the noise is coming. If you can just adjust it, is then it? The voice will be better. Thank you.
Now, is it fine? Do you find it
yes,
fine?
Sir.
No.
Yes, sir. Now, better.
So, Gaurav, we talked about these protocols. So this is one of subset of protocols which can be followed, but a very useful article for references in clinics, which all of radiologists can find for easy references. This one is 15 December. So what I will be talking about the ultrasound in inflammatory arthritis, I will discuss imaging in rheumatoid arthritis in detail. Then I will see and we will discuss the imaging techniques in ultrasound of rheumatoid arthritis. Then we will see the findings in inflammatory arthritis in distal arthropathies. Then we will touch over spondyloarthrosis and reactive arthropathy. And then we will, after that, we would discuss about inflammatory arthritis in children and the injection techniques. After this presentation, we would have about half an hour discussion with our stalwarts here, right? So coming to inflammatory arthritis, the common type. Inflammatory arthritis is a disease of the synovial joints. So what happens in rheumatoid arthritis is, there is a hypercellular panus formed from the inner layers of the synovium. And what the panus does, it acquires new vessels and it erodes the bone and eats up the bone where there is no hyaline cartilage. And between the area where there is no hyaline cartilage and between and up to the area where the joint capsule attaches, this is called the bare area. So what my imaging will show you is synovial panus formation on the ultrasound, vascularity within the panus, and erosions. So these three findings will be the hallmark of disease process in rheumatoid arthritis. Whereas, and rheumatoid arthritis, it respects the hyaline cartilage, whereas gout, we have these tophaceous, tophi, amorphous gouty tophi, which would erode and which would just deposit either within the synovial fluid, within the joint capsule, over the hyaline cartilage, within the soft tissues, within the tendons or the muscle. So the tophi do not respect anything. These are more sharper erosions here normally. And we also see an associated synovitis, effusions or power dopplers in gout. Whereas in spondyloarthrosis, we have similar erosions like rheumatoid arthritis, except that the erosions are not in the bare areas or within the this is where the joint capsule attaches. So the erosion which we will see in the spondyloarthrosis will be at the enthesis. So this we will discuss in detail. And coming to rheumatoid arthritis. So why rheumatoid arthritis assessment? Because about if we are 100 of us watching this presentation, one of us will have rheumatoid arthritis. So we would always want to have these imaging technologies available, and how is it useful? It has been primarily used as to ultrasound has been found better than clinical examination in assessing for synovitis, which maybe one of rheumatologists will not agree, but it actually shows the active synovitis. Ultrasound is useful for evaluation of subclinical inflammatory process and detection of subclinical synovitis when we are suspecting a rheumatoid arthritis or when it is an early arthritis and we are not very specific about having reached the diagnosis. And it also helps us in assessing the inflammatory activity, the global inflammatory activity, and once and also help us in reaching the diagnosis as per the ACR EULAR guidelines. Also, once we have made the diagnosis and we are treating the patient, ultrasound is useful in monitoring response to therapy. I'm not going into all the articles. We will have a discussion on that. It helps us in evaluation of suboptimal treatment to responses. If you think that the response is suboptimal, we can actually escalate the therapy or change the therapy. And also, very interestingly, about a third of the patients which we think are in clinical remission might have activity on the ultrasound. Although it is a slight matter of debate whether we take the power Dopplers at the endpoint or not. And it is really, really useful in assessing palindromic rheumatoid arthritis and used for, in clinical trials, ultrasound has been used for having the endpoint in clinical remission. And prognostication of disease, there is again a query regarding this. So the ultrasound has a role in making the diagnosis, in monitoring the therapy and giving an endpoint to see whether we can taper off the therapy. So what are the findings of ultrasound in rheumatoid arthritis? Synovitis is the hallmark of disease activity in rheumatoid arthritis. Synovitis is basically power Doppler signals within the hypertrophied synovium. And what does the synovitis do? It causes bony erosions. Erosions which have an active associated synovitis are called active erosions. Once the synovial or the pannus has burnt out, we will only have erosions which do not have any active synovitis with it. Because rheumatoid arthritis is a disease which has a waxing and waning course. The patient can have flares in between. And when we start with the treatment, the patient will go into remission. Some of the patients will go into remission with time on their own. But mostly we need treatment so that there is not enough joint destruction so as to cause a limitation in movement. So our goal is to keep the patient physically in a situation so that the joints are not eaten up. Associated synovitis is there in tendons. We would have a tenosynovitis, tendency effusions, hypertrophies or nodules. And we again have soft tissue nodules, which we do not very commonly see. Joint effusions again are a debate, but really useful in children as a disease marker for new effusions coming up in a patient which is on treatment, maybe a sign of new disease activity. Secondary involvement because of degenerated process or because of compartment syndromes like in rheumatoid for, we will have a compression of nerves. We might have a hyaline cartilage destruction secondary to secondary osteoarthritic changes and joint destruction. And enthesitis, although it is not part of the classical rheumatoid arthritis, it will be a part of the spondyloarthrosis. It is basically a hypoequic thickening of the entheses with or without power Dopplers or, this again has to be taken. If we find an enthesitis and we have a rheumatoid, then whether we are dealing with a frank rheumatoid or we are dealing with an overlap syndrome. Also, ultrasound is quite useful when we, I get referrals from my guru in that, sometimes when he thinks that it is not rheumatoid, the patient is sent to me, I show them all the joints and then they are convinced because they have been put on treatment just empirically, even without, the bloods being there. And also about 15 to 20% of patients, which are called seronegative rheumatoid arthritis, which do not have the two markers, anti-CCP and rheumatoid factor positive, and we still have the inflammatory process. So the ultrasound is quite useful for assessing for the disease activity in them. So what is synovial hypertrophy synovitis? It is not a vague term. So we will just talk, we have about 6 minutes more.
Yeah.
So, we just talk about the definition. Synovial effusion fluid. Synovial effusion is any abnormal. Abnormal means more than what would normally be there, hypoequic or anequic intra-articular material that is displaceable and compressible. Can you see here? I can displace and compress the tissue inside, but does not show a Doppler. The synovial effusion can be hyperequic, it can be hypoequic, or it can be isoequic, but it will never show any power Dopplers. Whereas synovial hypertrophy, which is again the hallmark of the disease, will have abnormal, it is basically abnormal. Abnormal means which is normally not there. The Omraak changes data, hypoequic, isoequic or hyperequic intra-articular tissue that is displaceable but poorly compressible, which may or may not show a Doppler signal. But when it shows a Doppler or a pannus formation, then it is an active synovitis. Tenosynovitis, again, hypoequic or anequic thickening of tissue with or without fluid within the tendon sheath. And believe me, in all MSK ultrasounds in any pathology, be it rheumatoid or else, we want to image in two particular planes to show whether the pathology is there. And coming to bone erosion, which are of the inflammatory process, bone erosions are intra-articular discontinuation of the bone surface that is visible in two perpendicular planes. First point is intra-articular, between the area of the hyaline cartilage and the joint capsule. So we have to be careful whether we are dealing with a spondyloarthritis erosion or we are dealing with a rheumatoid arthritis erosion. So just showing you the grading of synovitis when we have intra-articular tissue, which is partially compressible, non-displaceable, or you know, we have synovial hypertrophy on grayscale as synovitis on grayscale. When we have no intra-articular tissue which is distending a joint, it is called as a grade zero synovial hypertrophy. When we have intra-articular tissue which is just bridging the joint lines, it is a grade one or mild hypoechoic synovial hypertrophy. When there is a bulge which we can see here, then it is a grade two synovial hypertrophy. And when the synovial hypertrophy extends to the diaphysis, either one or both, it is called a grade three synovial hypertrophy. Once we have established there is grayscale tissue there, we put in the power Dopplers. And when we have to do the correct power Doppler settings, which we will discuss later, and we have no signal means grade zero, up to three vessels or two vessels with a confluent vessel is a grade one signal. More than three vessels, but occupying less than 50% of the grayscale synovial hypertrophy is a grade two. If it is more than 50% power Doppler occupying the synovial hypertrophy, it is a grade three power Doppler. So the synovitis grading will help us in monitoring the disease activity. But then we are not very successful in grading erosions, because small erosions will join together and form a big one. We can just, and they, in children, they might be healing in some process, but in adults, once they form, these can be telltale signs of old disease. Or if they are active erosions, we might have a power Doppler within, and that means that they might form bigger erosions later. So what I mean by dynamic examination is sometimes you have to come, you do a flexion extension or you do particular maneuvers to take out the erosions from the hidden areas. Like here, we are doing a flexion and extension, and we could actually show the erosion here. So what are the telltale signs of synovial rheumatoid arthritis ultrasound? We have and look at this. Can you see, we are not just touching the skin at all. We're just placing the probe on the skin without touching, and we have exuberant jelly here so that we do not compress. That I'll show you in the next slide. Hypoechoic tissue with power Dopplers, with erosions and active erosions here. So we have scanning protocols, and after the scanning protocols, I'll just take a break maybe, and then we will continue after the PM's address. So, why protocols? Because then what to do? How do I compare what I have done the next time the patient comes to me, or when Dr. Rath says that, do the 22 Spanish 22 joint protocol, means a very specific question he has asked. I will answer that question in the same format when he has asked me to answer. So maybe somebody in Canada will take a 12 joint or a 6 joint protocol, but if you're in the NHS, they will take a 7 joint protocol of Marina Bacchus, where you use the Palmer aspect for the grayscale mode and the dorsal aspect for the power Doppler. Or the Swiss sonar, which is the nearest to the disease activity scoring protocol, where again, then they use the Palmer views for B mode and the Doppler for the dorsal aspect for the Doppler, because the recess in the dorsal aspect will be less compressed on the neutral position. Or maybe a 6 joint protocol in Canada. But the EULAR ACR has given new guidelines for diagnosis of rheumatoid, in which we are using the ultrasound, but when we suspect, the ultrasound will add to the armamentarium of the rheumatologist. So where is the Doppler useful? In the superficial joints or the deep joints or the intermediate? The Dopplers are really useful in the areas where we can actually clinically examine. But in the deeper joints, like maybe the elbows or the shoulder or the hip joint, the Dopplers are not useful, but the ultrasound per se is very useful because the clinical examination in these joints is not very useful. So coming just the last 2-3 slides before the break, imaging, how do we, we'll just discuss the last part and then take a break. We use the highest frequency possible, the correct magnification, the correct depth, correct focal zone, and the overall blackness has to be there. This is a basic slide which we show in all MSK programs. the PRF has to be the lowest, and when we sit, when we, you know, if there is a vessel here, we take a superficial vessel, take a Doppler box, include that and standardize according to that superficial vessel, and then we take the synovitis within the synovium or the joint. Highest frequency, and more importantly, we hold the pen probe like a pen and rest little finger on the patient, use a jelly standoff, dynamic imaging, and we take the little finger as a button. And very important, if you read Wakefield's article, even gravity positioning of the organ will affect the synovitis, hyperemia, or the grading. So the examination has to be in the neutral position in the joint examined. And we have, sir, should we take a break now?
Yeah.
So there are close to 900 people actually who are live on both the platform on YouTube and on our.
We are good, but I think we have to respect the mandate of the nation. We will just take a break for the Prime Minister address, sir. Riju, sir.
Yeah, that we already announced earlier. I think we'll take a break for and resume the session at 8:30.
Fine, sir.
Sir, who all? Dr. Rath is not there. Achha, are we alive or we are not alive? Dr. Sujata?
Gaurav, are we alive? Are we live on YouTube right now?
Ha.
I'll come back in 20-25 minutes.
No, we'll come back in 15 minutes or we just discuss ki aage kya karna hai. Jis iske andar...
Gaurav, are we live on YouTube?
We are. We're just stopping. So, we can discuss. No problem.
Till now,
Raghav, there was a little bit of voice breaking. That is a lot of complaints coming in.
Should we use some other?
Can you see the screen?
Yeah, we can. We can see the screen.
Is it clear?
Please make it a slide share. Yeah.
Is that okay?
Yeah. Yeah. Fine. Are we live, Gaurav?
Sir, I'm just checking. 1 minute. Yes, sir. We are live, sir.
Yeah, yeah. So we are resuming the session. Welcome back, everyone. Before we resume Dr. Raghav's session, we have got a short presentation from Dr. Sujata Sayani on the essentials of ultrasound in pediatric rheumatology. Over to you, Dr. Sujata.
Thank you so much, Dr. Matthew. And hello to everybody in the virtual world who is logging on today. So as we wait for Raghav to get back his technology together, I'm just going to talk to you for a few minutes about the role of ultrasound in the pediatric rheumatology practice. So really, looking at using ultrasound should not be a very new idea, because it's essentially an extension of our clinical examination. In fact, as you begin to do ultrasound as a clinician, you really learn to improve your clinical skills as well. And we realize that as clinical doctors, we've really forgotten a lot of our anatomy. And as you begin to do the ultrasound, you realize the importance of knowing the anatomy and the anatomical landmarks for the children. In addition to precision injections, when you are doing an ultrasound, it's fairly easy to engage with the child. The child does not need any anesthesia. One can do multiple areas of assessment at one time. But yet, studies have revealed that very few pediatric rheumatologists actually do scanning real time in their clinics, much more in Europe and as compared to US. And one of the most important reasons put forward is time and the lack of core knowledge of both anatomy and the utilization of the ultrasound machine. There are a few issues about ultrasound, which is certainly operator dependent. One needs to know the anatomy in detail, need to be familiar with the age-related norms, and there are some areas which don't have very good acoustic windows. And of course, you have to inform the parent about what you're doing, always examine both the joints and know the normal first. In addition to the role of ultrasound in the assessment of children with juvenile idiopathic arthritis, there are several other areas which have been listed where ultrasound can be a good friend of the pediatric rheumatology clinician. So look at the pictures of the ankles of these three little children, and I'm sure you'll agree with me that it's not very easy to understand, first of all, which side is involved. And secondly, if you can gather the right side, for example, this ankle is obviously swollen, where is the swelling coming from? Is it coming from the tendoacalus? Is it coming from the medial tendon sheets, or is it coming from the peroneal compartment? Or in fact, is it the posterior recess of the tibiotibial joint? So clinically, sometimes some joints, especially the ankle, are rather difficult to pick up. And if you look at the role of ultrasound in pediatric rheumatology, in fact, I think the role is going to expand. It is going to help us to understand the current classification, to guide certain treatment strategies and definitions, to define remission more appropriately, and maybe it will be incorporated in future classification criteria as well. What we see in the West, where they see a lot of patients with oligoarthritis, in the realms of the children with juvenile arthritis, it's very different in India. We looked at our own data, and we find much more of enthesitis-related arthritis as compared to oligoarticular disease. So for us as pediatric rheumatologists, understanding the enthesial complex in children is quite important in India. Quite important. And whatever year we have looked at our data, it's quite remarkable that enthesitis-related arthritis and children with systemic arthritis form the bulk. What are the important unique features of MSK ultrasound in children? There are two things you need to focus your attention to. One is the fact that the joints of many children have a lot of cartilage, and this is because the articular surfaces of the joints have secondary ossification centers, and there's a lot of cartilage, which is both articular and hyaline, and sometimes difficult to distinguish one from the other. And second is because the long ends of the bone are growing, you have a lot of vascularity as compared to adults. So let's look at the ossification center with this example. So here's the end of a long bone, and you have got the bony diaphyses. You then have a small bony ossification center, which is surrounded by hyaline cartilage. As the child gets older, this hyaline cartilage will become more bony. So this will be accompanied by more bone and less hyaline cartilage. And ultimately, the hyaline cartilage will be fully ossified, and you'll have a clean margin of articular cartilage that is left behind. And what is the issue here? The issue is that when you are doing an ultrasound, both the articular cartilage and the hyaline cartilage are anechoic. And you know that even fluid can be anechoic, and therein lies the confusion. But if you just keep a handle on the anatomy, and I'll show you some examples, it's not very difficult to understand what is happening. So nature is really quite fascinating, and the ossification centers have a very standard march in both girls and boys, so that if you look at the ossification centers of the carpi, once you have the ossification center of the capitate that begins in the first year of life, you then have via an anti-clockwise march the ossification centers of the other carpal bones. So note that when you are putting the probe for the wrist joint, you are using the anterior longitudinal scan, and you're going to go through the radius, you're going to look at the lunate and the capitate. And that then is the standard anterior longitudinal scan. And what do you see when you look at it in children? And I'll just show you a couple of examples. So here's the anterior longitudinal scan for a child who's just 2 to 4 years of age. And can you see that the lunate does not have any ossification center? Here there's a small center of ossification of the lunate. It's larger, and here is the adult variety. So here you can actually grade the ossification centers as the child is getting older. Similarly, when you look at the ultrasound examination of, for example, the metacarpophalangeal joint, don't get confused that this is a erosion. Be clear that this is the growth plate, and this is the distal physeal end of the metacarpal. And here you can see the cartilage outline as a hyperechoic line. So just familiarize yourself with the anatomy and look at the difference of a child who's 10, where the growth plate is obviously open. And here you have the secondary ossification center, which has matured and fused with the diaphysis of the metacarpal bone. And here the age of the child is 15. So you should get used to the different anatomy of the ultrasound structures as you view them in children, especially as they grow older. So it stands to reason that as the child gets older and the bony ossification increases, the cartilage thickness will reduce in parallel. All right. Similarly, let's pick up another example. This is the elbow joint, and this is the X-ray of the elbow joint. And again, the march of the secondary ossification centers occurs in a fairly regular fashion. And a very easy acronym to remember is CRETO. So the capital M, radial head, internal or medial epicondyle, trochlear, olecranon, and then the external or the lateral epicondyle. And these are the years at which you have the development of these centers. But please note that if I have an inflammatory joint disease of the elbow joint, then the fluid is going to get collected in the fossa. And the fossa remain the same for both adults and children. So even though the trochlea may be unossified or the capital M may be unossified, we should not get confused by that. So when you are doing the ultrasound of the elbow joint, you have the standard scanning sites. So here you have got the medial or the anterior humero-ulnar scan. And here when you place the probe, you have the anterior humero-radial scan. So let's look and see what happens in the child. So here you have the anterior humero-ulnar anterior longitudinal scan. And here this child is about 6 years of age. And can you see that this is the fossa where I'm going to look for any inflammation, look for synovitis or fluid. And all this anechoic stuff is the cartilaginous portion of the bone, which is not yet fully ossified. So we should not be confused by the cartilage, which is coming from the ulna and the humerus. We should focus on the fossa, which is going to show you disease. And here you can see that in the lateral scan or the anterior humeral radial scan, you have fluid here in the lateral fossa. And here you have the unossified portion of the radial head. And here you have the unossified cartilage of the capital M. And this is the short axis of the same. So it's important to understand the anatomy and know what is the location of the synovitis or the effusion. And this can prevent a lot of confusion, especially when we are not used to doing pediatric scans. Similarly, if you look at the power Doppler signals that occur in the articular surfaces of the children, please note that normal articular areas in children are going to have blood supply, which is more than what you see in adults. And the reason for that is the growing end of the bones. So when you see a blood vessel that is entering into the fascicle, this is physiological. Similarly, you see it entering into the growth plate here, and this is again physiological. And then here you have the patella. This is the unossified cartilage of the patella because this is the anterior longitudinal scan of the knee. And again, this is a physiological blood vessel. It should not be confused. Here again, you can see that this blood vessel channel here is going into the physeal plate, whereas some of these are in the fat pad, extrasynovial, and again, not pathogenic. And here again, you have a feeder vessel. So we need to be a little careful when you're doing ultrasound in children. So the normal physiological blood vessels are going to be seen at the epimetaphyseal ends, at the intracartilaginous area of the small bones and the patellae, sometimes in the fat pad. They are seen more commonly in the wrist, in the tibiotalar, at the knee joint. And in the MCP, this is one area which is somewhat difficult to understand because the blood supply and the vascularity can change in the small joints of the hand depending upon the ambient temperature and the activity the child has been involved with. The probe placement is standard both for children and for adults. And note that we are always looking at recesses rather than looking at the main joint, which is often hidden between the bony surfaces, right? And then there are standard definitions which have been given for both the pediatric and the adult population. And these are very similar to what has been described in the adult world as well. And I will not go through each of these. There are new pediatric synovitis scores which are as yet being developed. And here's an example then of a scoring system which has been done for the ankle. And here you can see that this is normal recess. Here you can see that there is a mild reduction of the Seagull sign and a little bit of fluid here. And this is a grade one. Here you can see that there's some bulging of the joint capsule and this is grade two. And here you can see a remarkable bulge of the joint capsule of the ankle joint. And this would then be described as a grade three synovitis. And this is again, work in progress and not defined for all the joints as yet. So let's again look and see at a very simple scan of the knee joint, the anterior longitudinal scan of the knee, and how does it differ as the child gets older. So here is the scan of a two-year-old. You can see the quadriceps tendon. You can see the distal end of the femur. This is the growth plate. Don't get confused. This is the femoral condyle. And this is the cartilage covering the femoral condyle. And you can see very well the end of the cartilage plate here. And here you can see the site for the patella where there is no ossification nucleus. Here you can see that the ossification nucleus of the patella is just beginning to be seen at the age of 5. Here the patella ossification center is much bigger. And here in a 15-year, you have the adult formation of the patella. So don't get confused. These are normal anatomic changes that are occurring as the child is getting older. Now that you've understood how to do the scan and how to visualize the fluid or the synovitis, what then is normal and what is abnormal? So here you have a very small effusion here. And is this pathological? So this is actually a 3 millimeter normal effusion. Here you have an effusion which is a little more marked. And here you have a very prolific effusion along with synovitis and fluid. So you can actually even try and grade it. And as you follow up these children, it becomes much easier. Similarly, for the ankle joint, you have a modest effusion. And then here you have normal here and you have a significant effusion. And what is very helpful here is the cartilage interface sign, which can be very well seen when the probe is held exactly parallel to the site that you want to enter. I can skip some of these. And then show you another scan of the hip joint. This is the anterior long of the hip, and you can see this is normal. Here's a bulging capsule here, and you can see a prolific synovitis, and again, a moderate effusion here. And here's a prolific synovitis of the anterior scan of the wrist joint, along with a significant power Doppler signal. And note that here the power Doppler signal is intra-articular and intrasynovial. The enthesis is a fascinating area which can be studied in children. And here you can see a swelling of the patellar tendon on one side, and it is normal on the opposite side. So it can be well studied. Here's a very classic sign that we find in children who have got arthritis of the ankle joint is the presence of tenosynovitis, which must be defined, as Dr. Raghav said, in both the short and the long axis, and you look at the blood flow as well. Here's the tenosynovitis of the biceps tendon in the short axis, normal on the opposite side. And I think I would like to conclude with this and leave you with a very simple take-home message that yes, there is a steep learning curve, but it's an exciting new field. All of us need to delve into it. And I think that the ultrasound is really this new stethoscope of the pediatric rheumatologist. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sawhney. Thank you, Dr. Sawhney, for the wonderful overview of the role of ultrasound in pediatric rheumatology. Now, we will resume Dr. Raghav's session. Raghav, can you please?
Yes, sir. I think.
Sawhney, can you stop sharing your screen? Yeah, right.
So, in fact, sir, as a team, I'm lucky that you're in Gangaram Hospital when you work with the pediatric rheumatologist. You do the ultrasound, see the patient, make the diagnosis. You know, again, you follow up, you get the criticism, and then you get the reward, you know, side by side. When you see these children smiling, it is actually, you know, so exciting. And all of us keep on learning. Like, you know, we're trying to make some new protocols for children, whereas we don't have any. And we keep on learning what in ultrasound was the normal, what was the rule. Like we said, we examine all joints has become maybe a different viewpoint, which Dr. Rath will add on later. So, sir, starting with my presentation where we left, sir, should I?
Yeah, sure. Please. Your slides on the technical.
Yeah, you know, I just. So this was where I started. Can we see, sir? Is it?
Yeah.
Am I audible? Yeah. Am I visible?
Yeah.
So just try to change my.
Please make it slideshow. Slideshow.
I made the slideshow. Is it fine?
Yeah. Fine. Please go ahead, Raghav.
Thank you, Dr. Sujata ma'am, for covering for me. And, you know, it is when we started where I left the technique, as ma'am said, and, you know, as we know, that we have to be very careful. And how we have progressed is because of the advances in the technology and the advances in our own knowledge of anatomy, what these probe will show. So we used to have these... 3 to 18 megahertz. Now we used to have 5 to 18 megahertz probes. So when we do coming back to the technique, as we said, when we do the Doppler settings, we have to hold the probe like a pen. This is being held so that we can show the image. And this is called a jelly standoff. And when we do a power Doppler assessment, when the jelly standoff is correct, we would get the correct power Dopplers. And this is how the Doppler settings will make a difference. In the same synovitis, same power Dopplers, if the different PRF settings, we will have a different grade of synovitis. So you have to standardize what we are seeing. And from there, we have to go on and do the imaging. Also, the ultrasound is really useful in assessing for the, I think the videos are not. I think I'll have to The videos are not working in this. So why specify the protocols? This protocol have to be specified because, you know, we have to be very clear that what we have followed, what I am talking should be the same language as Dr. Rath is talking. And we cannot have a different language which you're talking. So if you're following a protocol, and whether we are dealing with gout and we have different protocols for spondyloarthrosis, specify a protocol and specify if you're not able to complete the protocols. Like I said, in the NHS, you might just be doing the seven joint protocol. Or if Professor Malviya is sending me a patient of fibromyalgia, I would want to actually screen all the joints and reach a conclusion whether there is no any disease activity or not. Also, there are scenarios like extensor carpi and laryngeal tenosynovitis might be the only sign early rheumatoid arthritis. So we cannot ignore subtle signs when there is the bloods are positive. And sometimes there are overlap syndromes which we have to understand. So what all can we see? We are other things which we are possibly doing is contrast ultrasound. And then we are also doing elastography. We are also doing a new technique, which was there in my presentation because there was some technical glitch. I changed the computer, but because of photoacoustic imaging in which we use the laser and the image is formed from the synovial, the new angiogenesis and the blood there, and which gives an image of inherent contrast. This is what Dr. Girish, Girish Gandikota, introduced me to this when I was discussing this presentation with him. So the contrast ultrasound, ultrasound contrast is a blood pool agent. And when we have a synovitis, which might be echogenic, it will still show up as air bubbles. And when we give a max PI there, we would see the, because these vessels are, new angiogenic vessels, which don't have the endothelium, just like the tumor vessels, they will show up the ultrasound contrast wherever we have the new vessel formation. Elastography per se hasn't been found quite useful. So I might have to change my computer for the videos. So this is how the contrast ultrasound will show up.
Yeah, videos are working.
No, only in this one. So in the end we could actually see. So this is how the contrast ultrasound will show. So just a word about, nothing will be complete unless we talk about artificial intelligence and how it is coming up. Because the main problem which we follow, we have in MSK ultrasound is we have to label all the structures and we have to find the correct, image. So here the SMSK technology like Sonoscape has, they would actually, if you have the correct section, they will label the images for you and make your work very easy. So this technology is available. And then we also have this. This is because of deep learning. If you capture a video, then the computer might be able to just, give you the correct section. So this is a new technology and which is coming up, and artificial intelligence is going to creep in and help us be another hand for us for the future, right? So having said a word about the new advances and then coming to the protocols, how we actually do them. So if you talk about the EULAR protocol, European League Against Rheumatology protocol, it's a very well-defined, very extensive protocol in which we do the wrist extensors, we do the long axis, mid-wrist, the volar and the radial long axis and the short axis in the scaphoid unit ligaments. We look for these recesses and the power Dopplers which are normal and the pathology. In all planes and all joints have to be shown in short and long axis. So from a practical point of view, these are the kind of images which both hands ultrasound would be required in a EULAR protocol. If you look at the extensors, the tendons, the joint recesses, the MCP joints in flexion and extension, and the molar in the dorsal aspect and the interphalangeal joints. So this would certainly be time consuming. So we have come up, different workers have come up. So this would complete the complete EULAR protocol. So this would come up to be a very, very lengthy process. So what we have come up, like Marina Backus in 2009, she has written about the seven joint protocol, which is very commonly used in the European countries, where they use the volar aspect of the second and the third PIP and the second, the third MCPs and the second and the fifth MTP joints and the dorsal aspects along with the wrist ultrasound. And the volar aspect, they see the grayscale synovial hypertrophy, and the dorsal, we see the power Dopplers. Or we, and we have a scoring system like this, we can easily score, and most of the rheumatoid arthritis patients can be picked up in this. So just showing you a few cases in rheumatoid arthritis, we might have a synovial hypertrophy with associated erosions or a synovitis. So this is how you demonstrate compression. Can you see here? When we talked about intra-articular tissue, which is partially compressible and non-displaceable, like here you can see is, this is synovium, and the tissue which is compressible and displaceable is the effusion inside. So we would want to show the pathology in long axis and in short axis, in flexion and in extension. So that was established, whether it is intra-articular or extra-articular, and whether it is synovial hypertrophy or synovitis. Again, a similar case, we have synovial hypertrophy. Then we have power Dopplers in this. Maybe in one of the few, a few joints will show you synovial hypertrophy, while the other set of joints might show you an active synovitis, and the other side, third site, might show you an erosion which is active. So it, when whatever protocol you are following, finish that protocol, and it would be wise to also to examine joints which appear to be swollen. And sometimes the rheumatologist will ask for a specific joints to be covered. So if you are not following this particular protocol, you will just write that the ultrasound was done for so-and-so XYZ joints. This was a case of a patient in remission. We just has this nodule, which is non-active patient in remission. This was a patient which was early rheumatoid arthritis, where we could see a tenosynovitis in the extensor carpi and laris. And my rheumatology colleagues will agree that this is a very nasty tendon. And about one third of them would present with tenosynovitis of this tendon to start with. So when you have a single joint tendon tenosynovitis and you suspect clinically to be a rheumatoid arthritis and your anti-CCP and rheumatoid factor are positive, so this cannot be ignored at all. This was a middle-aged lady who had been followed up in the clinic with Professor Malviya, and we had extensive tenosynovitis of the extensor tendons. She was a known case of rheumatoid arthritis who came with a flare. So this time we escalated the therapy, and still there was a lot of synovitis here. So this is the follow-up in February 2015 when we saw her. There was exuberant synovitis in the flare. We escalated the therapy, gave her a steroid shot also. So to our surprise, the synovial hypertrophy did not respond too well to the steroid shot. So because we could not afford biologics in this patient, we did a synovial biopsy, and to our surprise, we found it to be tuberculosis, and she really responded well to anti-tubercular treatment. Surprisingly, this patient also had spared MCP joints. So sometimes you can have a varied response in a flare. This was a patient, again, known case of rheumatoid arthritis. In this patient, the MCP joints in the wrists were normal, and we had a synovitis in the intertarsal joints and the foot joints. So it is not a rule that a few countries will just follow scanning of the hands. But if you have a joint which is active or inflamed, it is not a bad idea to put in a probe and examine there. We had tender nodules here, but the nodules were not actually the synovitis. We had synovitis at other areas in this patient. In fact, when we were looking at the nodules in the extensor tendons, we actually found synovitis in the intertarsal and the tarsal metatarsal joints, intertarsal and the intercarpal and the radiocarpal joints here. This was a gentleman of 70-year-old follow-up patient of rheumatoid arthritis. We had a subacromial subdeltoid bursa, which was thick in his case, and also had old large erosion, but the shoulder was painful. What actually we found was that the long head of the biceps still showed active synovitis. So in this patient, we had a reason to escalate his therapy. This lady was a patient of palindromic rheumatoid arthritis. A palindromic rheumatoid arthritis, we can discuss in our discussion part, because in this, what is happening is that we have this synovitis which will stay for a few days and migrate and just become all right and show up in the next joint. So some of these patients are treated wrongly. Some of them are even referred to a psychiatrist, whether they have disease or not. The bloods are sometimes confusing. Sometimes the blood help in this. But when you catch something like this, you at least definitely know that there is a synovitis which is active. This was a patient who was a doctor's relative who was clinically diagnosed as remission. Because we had access to the ultrasound and we did the ultrasound of the wrist, we actually found active synovitis. So instead of de-escalating, we actually escalated the treatment. And this is how we could change the treatment in this patient. So you can easily see how the ultrasound will show you subtle synovitis in areas and show you active erosions where clinically we could not find any. Again, as Dr. Rath said in our presentation discussion, that even rheumatoid arthritis might have a retrocalcaneal bursitis. There are a few overlaps. So this patient was an 18-year-old girl who was raised rheumatoid factor and anti-CCP was negative. And we had a retrocalcaneal bursitis, and then we have intertarsal joints, the MTP joints, we had synovitis. We also had tibialis posterior tenosynovitis in this. We had erosions in the calcaneum. So we had a mixed sort of a finding sometimes, and the clinician had to take the clinical decision. What we could tell on the ultrasound was that there is active synovitis there. So with that, I will finish my portion with rheumatoid arthritis. So coming to a very, very pertinent area, the distal arthropathies. In rheumatoid arthritis, we might have a doubt. There might be a doubt in the role of ultrasound. But in crystal arthropathy, we have no doubt. We are very, very specific when we talk about gout, when we talk about CPPD. So basically, gout is intra-articular or deposition of negative bifringent crystals. These are needle-like crystals seen on UV microscopy. So if we can aspirate fluid and on the UV microscopy... Pardon, sir? I think Dr. Sujata.
You can continue, sir.
So, these gout is very, very specific. These are negative bifringent, needle-like crystals. So this is specific for gout, because if we have a doubt of CPPD and gout, CPPD are positive bifringent rhomboid crystals. So this is the microscopy diagnosis. But the picture on the ultrasound is very different. This is usually what we see in the gout. The intercarpal joints are the first MCP joints, which have, MTP joints, which have erosions and swellings. This is what we see on the ultrasound. This is burnt out disease. This is not active disease. So this was the first MTP joint, which was actually having the erosions, but the active disease was in the fifth MTP joint here. So we could actually have a synovial hypertrophy with a few power Dopplers. We could identify a tophus in this patient. And we would also see this specific sign called double contour sign. As I discussed in gout, that the gouty crystals, the gouty tophi, do not respect any boundaries of the hyaline cartilage or the tendons or the ligaments. They will deposit anywhere and everywhere, even in soft tissues. But rheumatoid arthritis synovium, the pannus will be specifically attacking areas which is the bare areas. So this is the flexor, this is the flex knee showing the hyaline articular cartilage. And this is a knee which is showing an icing appearance, or what we classically call as a double contour sign. So when we have intra-articular hyperuricemia, the crystals of uric acid deposit on the hyaline cartilage as an icing, what is classically called as a double contour sign. It is another double contour sign described in rib fractures, but if you have something like this, it is classical hyperuricemia, and we generally do not have a differential diagnosis for this. I'm afraid this videos will not be working in this, because I had to change the computer. So I'll try to show. This is how the double contour sign will show, and this is how we will see a double contour sign. Comparing it with this is in the smaller joints. The MCP joints will also show a double contour sign. Normal hyaline cartilage of the MCP joint and the double contour sign in hyperuricemia. Then the tophi will be seen in the subcutaneous tissues, intertarsal joints showing tophi with active power Dopplers. So, Gaurav, can I go back and reload this? Because I think the videos are not working here. You just give me a minute.
So we can do the panel discussion or something?
No, I'll just finish with the gout and the injection part. Before that, we can do the panel discussion. So just showing you a few more slides of gout, and like we can have all the signs of erosion, the tophi, the double contour signs. Like in this patient, we have this double contour sign, which is a sign of chronic gout. We also had an active synovitis. So we can have similar findings. And you know, we can actually tell you whether this was an acute on chronic gout or a chronic gout or an acute attack of gout. CPPD, whereas, you know, if you compare it with the gouty arthritis, we have this echogenic, you know, layer above the hyaline cartilage, and in CPPD we have the echogenic specks within the hyaline cartilage. CPPD also is one of the diseases which would cause a knee joint swelling perhaps, or a painful joint, but the ultrasound is there to rescue, and we would be able to differentiate both these things. The x-rays might show you the calcification, the amorphous calcification in CPPD. So just a word about spondyloarthrosis. As we discussed, the erosions in gout will be at the enthesis here, whereas in gout will be at the bare areas, whereas the entheses are involved in spondyloarthrosis. So the hallmark of spondyloarthrosis would be an erosion at a distance from the joint, plus the spondyloarthrosis will also not spare the boundaries of the joint or the, you know, area involved. There'll be a spillover inflammation. There'll be an inflammation in the soft tissue. There'll be a tenosynovitis. There'll be a swelling in the soft tissues and maybe form something like a digit finger. So as you can see there, there is an enthesiophyte formed at a distance and there is an erosion at a distance. So when you see some inflammation like this, you might actually see if it is a tenosynovitis. So coming to reactive arthropathies will be just will be effusions in reaction to maybe a GI inflammation, behaving like inflammatory arthritis, which will disappear with time and have to be given the due respect. Talking about osteoarthritis is again thought to be a local low inflammatory activity disease, whereby we have these osteophyte formations rather than erosions. So the osteophytes, unlike the erosions as we talk, were step down artifacts in the intraarticular regions. These are step up artifacts. So you have these step up artifacts, and in the knee we might have a extrusion of the medial meniscus with joint space losses, which we can actually see on the ultrasound. Coming to the other areas where the ultrasound is useful is like in Sjögren syndromes or Sikka syndromes. If you're looking at the parotid glands, you might have this moth-eaten appearance, which will be really helpful in making the diagnosis. And with this, Dopplers can also be incorporated to see whether how the responses to the oral level stimulation are there. Then also we look for temporal arthritis and other inflammatory processes. We use that Hillo sign, but biopsies, although are more specific, but the ultrasound is easier to do, and we have a very specific protocol in doing this. So Gaurav, I'll just see if the videos are working, because I'll just try to fix the videos, and thereafter we have the injection protocols and the injection techniques after this. Okay. So you want to start the discussion before that?
Yeah, meanwhile, Raghav, you just get your technical part right. Meanwhile, I got Dr. Prasanthi Brath here, who is an eminent rheumatologist in Delhi. Dr. Brath, you have been doing ultrasound in your clinical practice. Do you do it for all the cases, and what percentage of cases do you depend on the ultrasound, and ultrasound findings, how much it will change the management strategies?
Thank you, Dr. Jijo. It's really an honor to be part of this webinar. Yeah, I've been doing ultrasound almost since 2009. And the learning curve is actually very, very, it's very steep, so it takes a lot of time. I think the place of ultrasound is just like any other investigation. It has to be done with a high pretest probability. One is that. to answer a particular question. So it's not something that we do randomly and repeatedly in all our patients. It is in a patient where you get stuck examination and you need an answer to a question. That answer could be whether the particular disease is articular or periarticular, for example. Is it inflammatory or non-inflammatory? And sometimes you can get stuck despite a good clinical history and examination. There can be doubts looking at the labs and everything. At the end of everything, you're still not sure whether you're dealing with an inflammatory or a non-inflammatory disease. That is the point where an ultrasound helps you. Suppose you're dealing with a pain in a rheumatoid patient. What rheumatologists have learned after ultrasound is that rheumatology patients are not immune to non-immune diseases. So they will have a lot of non-inflammatory conditions coexisting in them, which could be a cause of pain. And you always think of everything as inflammatory. So that is again a very important part where ultrasound helps you pick up a lot of things. For example, I had a patient of rheumatoid complaining of pain in the lateral part of the foot and a local tenderness, nothing else. I just couldn't make out anything. When I did an ultrasound, to my surprise, there was a ganglion cyst between the two peroneus tendons, and that was causing the pain. So certain things which you would never have imagined or thought of as a rheumatologist comes to the forefront when you do an ultrasound. Also, what is important is when you do an ultrasound, just like any other imaging, there is a lot of noise. So I think it's very important for the rheumatologist, if they are doing it or if they have a good radiologist, to always be in sync. Keep discussing the patient so that your radiologist also knows and makes you understand that, no, this particular thing could be a noise and this particular thing could be the disease. For example, a shoulder pain in an elderly patient. I mean, you could have degenerative changes in the AC joints. You could have degenerative changes in the glenohumeral joint. You could have tendon tears. Sometimes it's very difficult to identify the pain. So you have to go back to your clinical examination, go back to ultrasound. And sometimes you are able to know through a clinical examination that, well, I think the site of pain is the AC joint. And then the ultrasonologist tells you, because see, when you, the next step is, suppose you want to do an intervention, as Dr. Raga will probably tell us, an intervention is like maths. If you're not interfering in the right place, the patient will not get relief. Sometimes, you find a lot of people just, shoulder pain, periarticular, blindly injecting into the subacromial bursa, but the bursa is not the cause of pain. So when you inject at the wrong place, the person never gets relieved of pain. So I think both the radiologist and rheumatologist have to work in sync. So in my hospital, for example, in my clinic, I have my own ultrasound. In the hospital, many times I depend on my radiologist, Dr. Amit. So I always discuss with him. So a patient of osteoarthritis, well, I say, no, this patient has been having recurrent effusions. Apart from this, you also look at the cartilage, look at the hyaline cartilage. I'm suspecting CPPD. And then he'll tell me, yeah, there is CPPD there. So that would be something which a normal scanning one would not try to look at or would not pick up. And believe me, as they say, if your mind doesn't know, your eyes will never see. That's very true for clinical examination, also very true for ultrasound. So if you tell your radiologist or you ask your clinician, is there a particular thing you want me to look into apart from the routine screening of the knee? Are you suspecting anything? So he tells you that, no, I think you should look into the hyaline cartilage and I want to look for any calcifications. And behold, the calcification is picked up, which would have got missed in a normal scanning. And it has happened many times. And I send the patient back and he picks it up. So it's not his fault. So we have to interact. I think that's the key.
Okay, fine. So during Raghav's presentation, what we have observed is there are different protocols that have been followed by different. So what is the protocol that you follow or what you in your practice?
In my practice, I follow protocols and I'll tell you at the start that all these protocols have been well, tested and you could use any of these as long as you are repeatedly using it. So there are two ways of using a protocol. One is that you are assessing disease activity serially. If you're doing that, then you could use a fixed protocol. And if you're examining a particular area, then you have to do a complete examination. So I use the Swiss sonar and I also use the targeted ultrasound system, which is again a very good system. There's a very good image, and there's a paper on which you can actually fill up the different joints. So it says grayscale and power Doppler, and you start filling up grayscale 2, power Doppler 3, the wrist, or say the MCP, second MCP. So all MCPs, all joints are basically highlighted as power Doppler and grayscale. So I use that and I give that sheet to the patient so that the next time the patient comes, even sometimes the image is not there, you have that sheet with the scoring of each joint showing the grayscale score and the power Doppler score. And then you can, correlate that subsequently. So that's one thing which I use for follow-up if I'm following up a particular patient for remission. Otherwise, I use the Swiss sonar. I find it very practical and easy to do.
Dr. Saini, what about your protocols in pediatric rheumatology?
So in pediatric rheumatology, we don't have any standard six protocols. We really use it for a targeted examination when we are not very sure. So in children, especially between the ages of 2 and 5, they've got a lot of subcutaneous fat. And sometimes it's very difficult to understand, is this ankle joint swollen? Is this knee inflamed? The other area we find it extremely useful is to define how we're going to treat the child. So I give you an example. If I do an ultrasound of the ankle joint and I find only the tibiofibular joint is involved, I'd be tempted to just inject it or use an NSA. But if in that particular patient I find that the peroneal tendon sheath is involved, the tibialis posterior is involved, the tibiofibular joint is involved, there's a midfoot disease, then I'd be very much tempted to use systemic therapy rather than begin to inject the joint. So the other joint we find extremely useful is when we evaluate the wrist joint. As clinicians, what we think is the radiocarpal joint may in fact be the intercarpal joint, may in fact be one of the extensive tendon sheaths of across the wrist joint, especially compartment 3 and compartment 4. So it gives us huge value to examine the joints using an ultrasound. Sometimes we have febrile children who have lots of aches and pains, and if we are able to put the probe carefully on the biceps tendon and we find an effusion there, that's a very classical sign we find in children who have Still's disease. So I find it remarkably useful also to engage with the child, to convince the family of the child that this child has got arthritis, because a very common question we are asked is, the doctor, my child is only 4, you know, do children get arthritis? So even to convince them and have them on the same page, if we want to escalate therapy, if we want to decide any intervention, I find it remarkably useful.
So, Raghav, are you ready with your presentation, the third part of your presentation?
No, sir, I'll also show a few videos because I had to change the computer. It just went on updates. So though I'll show the videos of gout also. Yeah. And then the third part, the injection part. Yeah. And then we can, right, sir?
Fine. So why don't you resume? Why don't you share your screen?
Okay. You can see the screen, sir?
Yeah.
So here is, I'm really sorry for that glitch because, you know, If I put the presentation on the other computer so it can show the video. So this is something which I wanted to share with everybody, how the double contour sign in gout looks like. So I just wanted to feel when we see on the still image and when we do the Doppler, the dynamic scan, you know, the white of the cartilage is almost same or more than the white of the monosodium urate crystal deposition. So this is how the dynamic scanning will differ. And you can see the MCP joint here showing the double contour. Can you see that? This is how, what we mean by a high resolution scan. And we are actually showing you a very, very, very specific sign here. So this is how we document it as a dynamic clip. It is quite useful. So having shown that, I would, go back to the end of the presentation, where we talked about the injection part and the reactive arthropathies, like it might be an effusion in the knee joint or the shoulder joint, or you might have a suprapatellar bursa effusion with the synovitis, which after the infection will just go away. So these have to be very clearly and very specifically not to be labeled as rheumatoid arthritis or the other arthritides.
Raghav, if I may just add one thing. So what I've seen is mostly when you come to the double contour sign, a lot of people who are doing it early on can confuse it with the cartilage interface sign.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
My request is to remember that this is a inhomogeneous but hyperechoic as the cortex.
Yes, as echogenic as the cortex.
Angle of insonation. So that's the very important thing to remember. It has to be seen along the entire margin of the joint, not just one particular area. And it is as tight as the cortex, but irregular. So cartilage interface is very sharp and smooth. These are very irregular ones.
So we have to be like very careful, because if there is any effusion, even in the small joints, you will see the cartilage shining out and we make the diagnosis of gout. Right, sir?
Yeah, absolutely.
So as we were discussing before the presentation, like, sir, we wanted to talk about the extrusion of the menisci. Even for osteoarthritis, we were very, very specific. As Dr. Rath pointed out, that the extrusions might be the early signs in advanced osteoarthritic changes, right, sir?
Well, even in early osteoarthritis, and they found that even now in asymptomatic individuals, very interesting that in children of people who have had osteoarthritis, and these children are more than 45 years old, so I mean basically adults, they, when they looked at their medial meniscal, the medial meniscal has started to extrude, and over a period of time these patients actually started developing symptoms of osteoarthritis. So this may be now hypothesized to be one of the earliest signs in osteoarthritis.
So just coming back what Dr. Sujata ma'am showed in juvenile idiopathic arthritis, you know, sometimes we see the synovitis, we don't feel it, as ma'am said, we compare the left with the right and you will see a synovitis and do a few maneuvers, the joint will actually show you a lot of an exuberant synovial hypertrophy. And these joints were clinically very naive, but when we did the ultrasound, we look at the amount of synovial hypertrophy which we see. And also, like, you know, in children, as we pointed out, the unossified cartilage has not to be confused with the pathology. And the medial recesses, we have to be very careful looking for the synovitis where it is most pertinent. So, you know, having talked about this, having talked about the diagnostic part, which I'm sure Dr. Rath and Dr. Sujata will add. So the ultrasound has evolved over the years from the imaging technology or a technique in MSK pathologies as a standalone diagnostic, or with the MR or with the X-ray or with the dual energy CT, in inflammatory arthritis, in trauma, in sports medicine, to a pivotal role in therapeutics, especially in sports medicine and trauma, but also in inflammatory arthritis. We are doing steroid injections in the acute phase. We are doing synovial biopsies, and we are doing so many therapies in so many pathologies. You know, we had a controversy about the PRP in rheumatoid, which actually doesn't have a much role to play there. And then whatever we have done, whatever injections we have done, we follow up all pathology, all inflammatory pathology on the ultrasound. So a word about guided injections, small joint injections. I'll just take about 5-10 minutes. This is very important because if you want to start doing the injections, we discussed this in the sports medicine seminar, but if you want to start doing the injections, you have to know the in-plane technique and the out-of-plane technique. When you have enough tissue where you can go through and the needle, you can visualize the needle, you will do the in-plane technique, whereby the plane of the needle, the length, the needle is along the plane of insonation of the ultrasound. So you can see here, I will be visualizing complete needle here. And in out-of-plane technique, especially the rheumatology scenarios we work is because there is a blind area where we inject, but the area which is traumatized and we are directly above the tissue, we use the walk-down technique to examine. So what do we do is the out-of-plane technique traumatizes less, the in-plane technique needs more area to be penetrated through. So what we are doing is, and in the in-plane, we need to make the needle parallel to the probe. So this is called a jelly standoff. We use a jelly standoff whereby I have tilted the probe and put sterile jelly, and I'm going through the sterile jelly and injecting the injectate in the region of interest. A point about jelly, if you're using these processes, jelly has to be, sterile jelly is available. You must make it a point to use sterile jelly in all procedures, because if you infect a joint, then you are as good as your last mistake. So this was an in-plane injection whereby my probe is parallel to the needle length and I can see the complete needle by virtue of the reverberation artifacts. But when I'm doing an out-of-plane technique, like so here, I am doing the short access, access to the injection, I'm in the recess. And a word about the injections in tendon sheaths is, we would normally want to inject in the posterior aspect of the tendon sheath. This is also covered here because, you know, in the anterior aspect, if you inject, and invariably there is a little bit of steroid which leaks, what the steroid does is it discolors the skin. So maybe what a lady of 40 or 50 will not remember her pain because of the inflammatory arthritis. She will certainly remember that Dr. Raghav Agarwal injected and created a white patch. So you have to counsel your patients about the injections, what side effects they can have. You have to be very clear what the steroids. Steroids are our friends in rheumatoid arthritis, which help us in either tiding over the acute flares or adding to the treatment. So this, I think Dr. Sujata and Dr. Rath will explain to us why the steroids and how much and how do we do it. So the out-of-plane technique here and then the jelly standoff. This is how we make a triangle of jelly. we go through the jelly and we inject. So can you see here? This is just for demonstration purpose. We make the needle parallel. This is a very important technique which has been really useful. We've tried it in children. It really works. And we, the hand-eye coordination has to be there, but we go through the sterile jelly and into the area of injection. So a word about small joint or large joint or any injections is that when you are injecting, there is a target to be injected. There is a needle which you are using to inject, and you have your probe or your hand holding the probe. So at one time, either your needle moves or your probe moves, never both. So if you are panicking, if you first, what we do is we do the ultrasound, assess the area, mark the area of entry, see where entering, where we are entering the skin. And once we have entered the skin, we should be knowing where we expect to see the needle. If you think you are, if you are not able to look at the needle at that area, just stop moving your hand, move, shift your probe from side to side, realign, and then move your needle. So don't be in a panic, because, you know, if you go into a panic mode, it doesn't help the patient. It certainly doesn't help you. So I'll just show you five or six different types of injections, and I'll show you the kind of accuracy what the ultrasound can actually get, right? When we are doing injections for the MCP joints and the small joints, we must remember any injection inside the joint will be about 2 to 3 times more effective in decreasing the synovitis than an injection around the joint, because of the joint capsule not being very permeable to the steroid. And also a point, like if you're dealing with the wrist joint, the distal radioulnar joint is a separate joint from the radiocarpal joint. So unless your TFCC has been eroded by the synovial hypertrophy or the process of inflammatory arthritis, the injection in the distal radioulnar joint, in the radiocarpal joint will not go to the distal radioulnar. So we want to inject the distal radioulnar very specifically. And this is a joint whereby if the synovitis is there, the supination, the pronation is lost. So we could either go in long axis using the, you know, trajectory mode, or using the sterile jelly, whereby I would want it to avoid these small, nerves here. So we directly enter, see the trajectory, readjust the length, inject, and you come back. And especially for the MCP joints, when we are looking for pathology, we look for the synovitis, we look for the erosions, make the diagnosis, and do the injection, right? Bevel down when we go up, when we inject, bevel up when we go up inside, and bevel down when we inject. So if you look at this, this was a previous injection which had failed blindly. We re-injected. So again, the first question which we had in the chat box was, what size needle do you use? So I would want to answer that. If I want to do this MCP, MTP injection, I used a 1.5 inch 26 gauge straight single puncture, injected, and came back. So again, we do not use local anesthetic in small joints, because there is not enough space, and then there is a controversy regarding the use of intra-articular anesthetics. So you could see here the 26 gauge needle, single pierce inside, and you come up, and the whole procedure is about 30 seconds. But I would want to use a thicker needle if I am going to a deeper joint or a longer needle. And remember, one thing in interventions or in any injections is that the length of the needle has to be more than the length or a distance which is calculated on the body part on the probe before the procedure is done. It is so embarrassing that your needle will just reach till the periphery and you're not able to pierce inside. So a word about trigger finger. Trigger finger, what our colleagues, orthopedic surgeon, will be doing is they will just cut the pulley. So sometimes we have a ganglion cyst in the trigger finger. In the, this one is the A2 pulley ganglion cyst, which we made the diagnosis. And this was the pre-injection image, and post-injection, when the patient left, there was no triggering. So again, using the jelly standoff, entering, piercing, fenestrating the cyst without touching the needle, and injecting a little bit of steroid, maybe 0.2 ml or so. Or else what we do is we have also started using hyaluronic acid. And or the third thing which we can do is a stripping of the pulley using a curved needle and just pulling it out. Then you have the other kind of trigger fingers which are seen in spondyloarthrosis. You would have a irregular tenosynovitis and adhesions here. So what we are successfully doing is when we enter with the needle, we start injecting and start withdrawing. And here you can actually see how the adhesions are showing up when we are injecting. The adhesions are showing up and breaking on the ultrasound. So this also relieves the triggering. Then we have all these bouquet of injections. I'll quickly go through them. Why? Because sometimes you have a, you know, loculated tenosynovitis. I would want to not going long axis. I will go in short axis here behind the tendon and then inject here, right? Or I would do subacromial subdeltoid bursa injection. Again, the text says that you don't need to be too specific, but when you do a clear single shot injection, I think we get much better results. Olecranon bursitis, similar. Tibialis posterior long axis injections, tibialis and short axis injections. So again, both approaches have been used time and again, with the, you know, depending whether you have access space here and you have space and you can go in the long axis. We do not have space. This was a long axis sort of in plane injection on the long head of the tibialis posterior, an in plane injection in long head of the tibialis posterior in short axis of the tendon. So we have to specify the axis of in relation to the anatomical part. And when we talk about the in and out of plane, then we talk about the relation between the needle and the probe. So you have to be very specific, and then we reach the diagnosis. Like in children, if you want to inject the intertarsal joints, we make the trajectory and we inject enter, and then we want to be very specifically inside the areas. Also, sometimes these patients will have a, you know, associated plantar fasciitis, and so we do these procedures which have an overlap with osteo, with overlap with spondyloarthrosis and rheumatoid arthritis. So we have been using these intervention procedures. So once you have the MSK clinic working with you, the ultrasound, the rheumatologist will start sending you work, the sports person will send you the work, and the orthopedics will also send you the work. So there is an overlap of scenarios where you will actually have a plantar fasciitis pain in a patient of spondyloarthrosis or a reactive arthropathy. So here also we have, you know, simple scenarios, and we can actually treat the patient on the go. So I think I'll finish with that. So we have limitations. There is a steep learning curve, but I think we have to start. If you are not doing, at least start doing MSK ultrasounds. And we have a lot of, you know, faculty here, at least in India now. About 8 or 10 years ago, we had to spend a lot of money to learn. But now, you know, because we have, the rheumatologists have become sensitized to the ultrasound, the radiologists are seeing the need of ultrasound in inflammatory arthritis. We have to form a study group, and we have to keep on learning the way Dr. Riju has started this, you know, something like a common learning platform and help everybody. Because sometimes the rheumatologist speaks a different language and we speak a different language. So there has to be common language of protocols and norms which has to be followed. Then there are other limitations which all we know that, you know, the echo window is, has to be there. One point here is that the ultrasound certainly has an edge when we want to see for early bone edema, which would be a very specific sign for ultrasound in rheumatoid arthritis or inflammatory arthritis. You do need the correct equipment. Certification courses, well, I would keep the discussion from here only. Training courses, again, the IRIA, the Musculoskeletal Society, we have had training courses in Kochi. Dr. Riju has organized them at a very, very low cost. We are trying to, you know, get in and try to teach. And as a teaching group, we are also learning along with that. So to conclude, high resolution ultrasound with power Doppler is an internationally accepted technique of assessing inflammatory arthritis with specific validated scanning protocols and specific indication for the techniques which we use, right? And also we need to form a study group in interdisciplinary study groups, as we have just discussed, and this is a part of it. And there is, as Dr. Riju said, there is great potential as a specialized field of work, and we have to catch up what the world is doing, right? So with that, I will conclude, and we would go to the discussion part. I'm really sorry that I had to change the you know, computer, and
that's again, fine, that's okay.
So again, sir, coming back to the discussion part, if Dr. Rath would send me a patient and Dr. Sujata would send a child, so what do they want from me? What do they expect from the ultrasound? And will I be able to show them what they want? and what I show them, is it significant to them and will it change their treatment? Again, I, you know, the queries have to be answered, and I think there has to be a dialogue with the clinician. It can't be a single-sided written report with a differential diagnosis. It doesn't work that way in rheumatoid arthritis or inflammatory arthritis. Right, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Raghav.